I grew up in Port Angeles, Washington, which is a very wet part of the state of Washington. And so the streams that I was used to, that I grew up around, were perennial, they were large, they had salmon, they were what a lot of people think of when they think of streams and rivers. And it was only when I first started doing work down here in the Southwest that I realized that there's this whole other type of stream that's dry the majority of the time. With the current drought that we're in here in California, we've been experiencing some kind of unprecedented drying, and so streams that we thought always would have water have been drying up for the first time, and we've seen that actually across the whole southwestern United States. And so we really kind of want to look at how drying shapes streams and the critters that live there now, so that we can understand and make predictions about what might happen as the climate gets drier and drier. We have kind of a gradient of study sites. Really wet areas, but they still dry up for parts of the year, to moderately dry areas, to kind of the extreme drought areas in Pinnacles National Park, to get a full understanding for what impacts drying might have. And so during the wet season, like now, you see fish and invertebrates all through the flowing sections, but eventually, come May or June or July during the summertime, much of that creek is going to dry up. And so there are these little pockets of water that are still left at the end of the dry season, and they can be absolutely packed with critters. So essentially, there's kind of two ways, if you're an aquatic organism, there's kind of two ways to make it through the dry season. The more popular way, more common way, is to find one of these remnant pools and hang out in that wet area through the summer. But another way of doing it, if you have adaptations to survive drought, is to just be able to dry up and desiccate and survive in the dry stream beds until the water comes back. There are these specialized types of winter stoneflies in the family Capniidae that have these adaptations and that can just basically curl up and dry up with the stream as the stream dries up, and then wait there until the following wet season. Essentially, those stoneflies just rehydrate and come back to life. And so they're able to be the first things in the stream within 2 or 3 days of flow coming back. And then they provide a really important food source for the later colonists that come around, the more drought-sensitive species that show up later. And so if we project forward into the future and we see more drying, more drought, more intense conditions in the streams, then these kind of adaptations that these local populations might be evolving would be really important for thriving, you know, in that different future than what we have now. I would argue that every stream is important, but that's a biologist's point of view. From a more practical perspective, I would say having a good representation. You want to have species that are adapted to perennial flow and adapted to intermittent flow, because you don't know what might happen in the future and which one of those species might end up thriving under a different climate.